Right away, right?
Yeah, we're just gonna BS a little bit about, we can talk about what we're drinking and then go into it.
All right.
I don't have anything. I should go get one. Hold on,
Yeah,
I'll
you
be
have
back.
time. Okay. Yeah, and then I'll play that, and then we'll just do the quick arbitration thing, and then we'll do muscle flex and photo captions.
Okay.
I think it'll actually be end up being a shorter episode than usual. Because my muscle flexes aren't very good.
Okay.
You guys see the piece of wood that was under my TV? It's a the thing like right below the TV. That piece of wood with stripes on it. It's a piece of the old floor from Wharton Field House.
Oh, that's cool. Wow.
Quad City Thunder basketball on there.
David Robinson touched that.
Which one of you went to Moline?
I did. Okay. Well, I think I'm ready if you guys are.
Can be. Maybe not. You all right? You just wrong piped it. You're gonna be coughing for the next hour.
It's so cold down here. I have the thermostat set to 80 and it's still freezing.
What? 80?
Oh, yeah, but
Oh,
it
your
doesn't ever get
electric
to
thing.
it. Yeah. I left a SD card upstairs. I'll be right back.
Our gas bill was like $250 last month. Yeah,
Oh
it's
man, dude.
insane. Well, the whole thing, gas and electric, was 250, but it was like 220 of it was gas.
Are you on the budget plan?
No. Oh, is that where you pay like the same every month?
Yeah. It's
No.
I like it.
You do that, so then it
Yeah.
just averages your usage.
Yeah.
Do you have
So
MidAmerican?
you're
Okay.
paying more than you're using, like in the fall and the spring, basically.
Right, but at least you know what you're in for.
Yeah,
So
and
what
then
happens if you have if like this year they didn't know it was going to be 20 below for a month, so do they just eat the difference or do they just charge more?
No, like sometimes you end up with you paid more that of
Okay,
what you
it all
usually,
averages.
and then so they'll for the next year then they'll bump your payment
Okay.
up a little bit or down a little bit depending on how it went last year.
I might do that because that would be nice to have the same amount. Although this
Yeah,
might not be the
it
year
is
to do
nice.
it because, Jesus, the last couple of months have been nuts.
I think when it, like the first couple of years I was in here, it was only like $95 a month or something. But then it's like it's adjusted up to like 110 or something now.
All right, you guys ready?
Yep.
I think, yeah, our levels look okay. So, all right, here we go. On this week's episode of the IVMV podcast, we're going to play an interview that we did with Cubs television play-by-play broadcast. Start that over. Restore. Actually, I'm going to change the batteries on this thing. Just they're halfway. But usually that second half goes super fast. And I don't want anything to happen to this, so I'll be right back. All right, here we go. On this week's episode of the IVMV podcast, we're going to play an interview that we did with Cubs television play-by-play broadcaster Len Kasper. The Cubs avoided arbitration with all of the eligible players, including Jeff Samardzija. We'll read some internet muscle flexes and pick a winner for this week's photo caption contest. It's February 9th, 2014, and you're listening to the IVMV podcast. Hello, and welcome to this week's episode of the IVMV podcast. I am one of your co-hosts. My name is Corey, and I am joined by two other IVMV guys.
Hey, it's Andy.
Hey, and Kurt.
We broadcast these episodes live on Sunday evenings at 8:30 p.m. Central, and you can go to ivmv.com/live to watch and listen, and there's also a chat to log into there. And you can listen to our podcast on our website, ivmv.com, or you can subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, and really any of the podcasting apps that are out there. And you can connect with us on Facebook, ivmv.com/Facebook, Google Plus, ivmv.com/Google. We are at IVMV on Twitter and at IVMV Podcast on Instagram. Whew. So, yeah, got through that. All right, so since it's the off season, we're drinking. What are you guys drinking, guys?
Corey started early. I have a Summit Saga IPA, which I untapped this guy at a 4, it's a good one. I would rate it as one of the best inexpensive, comparatively, IPAs out there.
What was it called? Summit what?
It's a Saga IPA.
Got to be careful about use of the word Saga. Candy Crush, that company that put out Candy Crush Saga is already like telling other companies they can't use that word.
This does have like a little, what do you call the guy over the S there? The little
accent?
Yeah. So it's Sega, Saga. Saga. I don't know what that actually means.
All right, guys, you know what? We're going to have to start over.
That's all right. We were kind of coming out of the gate a little lethargic.
Yeah. And you guys couldn't hear the music, is that right?
No. Right. So, yeah.
Okay, so can you hear this? Could you hear that?
No.
Could you hear that?
Barely, but no.
Barely, huh?
I think it just might have been coming through the mic or something.
Wait a minute. That?
No.
No.
Okay. You really can't hear that. You guys aren't messing with me.
Right? No, no. Really not messing with you.
Is he still trying to fix it? I'm kidding, man.
And what the heck? I don't understand. Okay.
Let's go, Griswold.
I know. This is ridiculous.
I was going to say it's not probably not that important, but I guess we need that to be able to hear the interview, don't we?
Right, yeah.
I know, that's okay.
Got some Jake Bug queued up.
I did watch that KAXP thing.
Yeah, me too. I watched a lot of it. I actually like him.
Yeah, I do too. I had listened to his old, like, couple years old album a while back, but
when he was a couple years old,
when he was like 16, 17, something. I forget if that one that I watched had that interview part on it. It's pretty cool. Like, he basically grew up in the projects in England and then got signed and hasn't been home since.
Yeah, there was kind of interview interspersed throughout, but yeah. I mean, I haven't gotten to the part you're talking about.
Getting warmer.
Oh my. I know what the problem is. You can hear that, right?
I can hear you.
Oh, holy cow, there it is.
Yep, heard that one. That's the last thing I'll hear.
Sorry. So you can hear this?
Yeah.
Can I ever?
Is that too loud?
The track is a little more subtle, but the opening thing was pretty harsh. Did you turn it down? Yeah,
that's a lot
is
better.
Is that better?
Yeah, it's way better.
Okay. Good Lord. All right. You guys ready?
No, I'm gonna need about 10 more minutes.
Okay, here we go.
All right.
On this week's episode of the IVNV podcast, we're going to play an interview that we did with Cubs television play-by-play broadcaster Len Kasper. The Cubs avoided arbitration with all of the eligible players, including Jeff Samardzija. We'll read some internet muscle flexes and pick a winner for this week's photo caption contest. It's February 9th, 2014, and you're listening to the IVNV podcast. Hello and welcome to this week's episode of the IVNV podcast. I am one of your co-hosts. My name is Corey, and I am joined by two other IVNV guys.
Hey, it's Andy.
And Kurt.
And we broadcast these episodes live on Sunday evenings at 8:30 p.m. Central. You can go to ivmv.com/live to watch and listen as we do it. And my iPad just fell over. Sorry, guys.
It's all right.
I got a new case. Yeah. And you can listen to our podcast on our website, ivmv.com, or you can subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, and really any podcasting app. And you can connect with us on Facebook, ivmv.com/Facebook, Google+, ivmv.com/Google. We are at ivmv on Twitter and at ivmv podcast on Instagram. So, what are you guys drinking tonight?
I got me a Summit Saga IPA. It's a pretty tasty IPA, and I gave it 4 on Untappd, and I like it because it's fairly inexpensive for an IPA. You know, it's not $20 a 12-pack, so I'm a fan.
For me, I have an ESB Special Ale from Ska Brewing in Durango, Colorado. And I think I like some of their other beers a little bit better. This is probably a 3 on Untappd. I haven't checked it in yet, but I will do that shortly.
I am drinking a Revolution Eugene Porter.
Nice. I like that can.
I got the mug right here. But it is really good. Like, this is delicious. And I think I would have to give it at least a 4, maybe a 4.5.
Wow. So you've added porters to your stout.
Yeah. Your list of approved styles.
Yeah, and then I also my backup here, round number 2 will also be a Ska Brewing beer, and I don't really know how to say it. Vinifera Stout. I'm not sure. Have you had this one, Andy?
No, that's one I haven't had from them. So.
Oh. Well, I will let you know later in the show how it is.
All right. Sounds good.
We didn't broadcast live last Sunday because we were watching the Super Bowl, and Andy, you came out here, and I was thinking we should share what we did with our drinking that night, so that if anybody, you know, is going to have a party, it might be a good idea, kind of a fun thing to do.
Yeah, we did a mystery beer tasting event, I guess. So everybody brought a 6-pack, but the stipulation was that you had to wrap your bottles before you brought it in, so in tin foil or paper or something, so it obscures the labels and the caps and all that. And then so you just line them all up on the table, number each one, and everybody goes through and tries a little bit of each one. And then at the end, the idea is to kind of vote for which one you thought was the best and which one you thought was the worst, and then you have a big unveiling. So it's pretty fun.
It was fun. And Bob from Moline, he was out here. He supplied the mystery bottle of Bud Ice.
Was that the favorite? Did that make the top list?
I was amazed at how, after drinking all these like heavy beers, I was amazed at how watery that was.
It could have been lake water.
Right. Probably healthier.
But there's always, if you go, I've been to other, you know, other parties like this before too, and somebody, there's always some jokester that, you know, brings something like that, you know, Bud Ice in this instance. But the other one I was at, somebody brought like just Sprecher's cream soda or something, you know. Uh-huh. So hits your tongue.
You guys ever had anything good from Sprecher's?
I had anything from Sprecher's.
Go ahead, Andy.
I was going to say, you know how my mother-in-law gave me the Christmas present of that Beer of the Month Club for 3 months?
Oh, yeah.
Well, I got a couple of Sprecher's in my first shipment, and it was just all right.
Yeah. Man, I tried their hard root beer or whatever, and it was possibly the worst thing I've ever tasted in my life.
Yeah, see, some people awful. Love that stuff, but I don't like it either.
Yeah, it was I love root beer, but it was awful.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty bad.
But, yeah, so that was a fun little, you know, if you're getting together with some people and want to do something fun. I'll tell you, it's a quick way to feel pretty good. Because it only took about 10 minutes, and I was like, holy cow. But it was fun.
And so that way, that made the Super Bowl, like the lack of tension in the Super Bowl, like a little bit more easy to get through, I guess.
Right. Well, earlier in the week, the three of us had the opportunity to speak with Len Kasper, the television play-by-play broadcaster for the Cubs, and it was a really interesting conversation, and we talked with him for over 25 minutes, and it sure didn't seem like it. And we covered a lot of topics, and we think that you're going to really enjoy this conversation. So I'm going to play right now, and here is our interview with Cubs television play-by-play broadcaster, Len Kasper. All right, so send me a message in here, guys, if you know, the audio screws up or whatever, if you can't hear it.
Okay.
And we are joined now by Len Kasper, and Len is, of course, the play-by-play voice for the television broadcast for the Chicago Cubs. And Len, thanks for coming on the IVNB podcast.
Happy to do it, guys. Certainly thinking about better weather here in Chicago, and I'm certainly ready for spring training to start as soon as possible.
Yeah, that was going to be my first question. I was wondering if you're lucky enough to be in Mesa yet.
No, I won't head down until the end of the month. We're doing the first game from the new ballpark on WGN on the 27th. So I'll go down a couple of days early, and then I'll actually be there the whole time, as we've done in the past. Mick Gillespie, who does the Tennessee Smokies games in Tennessee, he and I are going to do all the webcasts on Cubs.com. And I think I might fill in and do a radio game for Pat. But we have 10 games on television this spring, so I think it'll be – fun for Cub fans to see all these young kids that we've been talking about here the last two or three years.
Yeah, we're ready for it.
Yeah, we're ready for spring to signal the end of this miserable winter.
Yeah, no doubt. you know, ideally, we would benefit from it and maybe get some nice weather in April, but I have a feeling that will not happen.
So once we finally do get to Wrigley Field, if we call the broadcast booth your office, not sure there's an office with a better view than your spot at Wrigley Field. What is it like having that office?
It's really amazing. I actually just received a copy of the Wrigley 100 official book from the Cubs in Major League Baseball, and I can't wait to leaf through it. I mean, I've skimmed it briefly, and there are some amazing photos in there. And, you know, they called me and asked me for some thoughts on being at the ballpark. And one of my thoughts was that while it's part of my routine to go to the ballpark, being at Wrigley is anything but routine. So I'm very fortunate in that regard. And yeah, the view is unbelievable. I mean, you can see a sliver of the lake on a clear day, obviously the rooftops and surrounding buildings in the city, and you get a great view of the ballpark. And you know, when the seventh inning stretch occurs, you look down and 40,000 sets of eyes are looking up at us. So it's the place to be, certainly when you're inside the friendly confines, and I wouldn't have it any other way.
Yeah, so there's really two sides to every coin, and I'm sure a lot of fans kind of idealize what you do for a living, but tell us about some of the less idyllic and some of the struggles of a 162-game season.
You know, 99% of my job is awesome. I guess the 1% that maybe is less than awesome is while I get to be at spring training and get out of this bad weather for about 5 weeks, you know, I have to leave my family, and you know, there's a lot of travel. I probably spend about, I don't know, 140, 150 days a year living out of a hotel. And you get used to it after a while, but it's really hard, especially when you have kids. I have a son who's going to be 13 during the middle of March, and you know, it's hard to be away. So that part of it isn't ideal. Now the flip side to that is I get all winter to be at home. And that's one of the big reasons why I don't do any other sports is you know, I'm already gone so much in the summer. I certainly don't want to miss even more in the off season. But really, aside from that, I mean, the travel's not difficult. Last year, we probably traveled more than any year that I've been in the big leagues, just because we went to the West Coast, I think, four different times. And after a while, you know, you really have to watch what you eat, how late you stay up. You know, you really want to stay in good physical shape, because the grind of a season, even on a broadcaster, can really get to you when you get into the middle of August. So hopefully over the last decade or so, I've kind of learned a few tricks in terms of trying to stay in tip-top shape mentally and physically as the season goes on. But it's really an all-or-nothing job. I'm either doing a game just about every day for about 7 months, or I have about 4 or 5 months where I can just kind of kick up my feet and be a family man.
Well, Len, players kind of have a certain routine in preparation for a game. What's the typical day like for you when the Cubs have a home game?
Well, a typical day for me, I mean, I guess if it's a 1:20 start, we have a lot of those, and that's kind of the iconic start time at Wrigley. I'm usually up around 7 or so. I jump on my computer for about a half hour, 40 minutes, just to read all the articles from all the local papers covering the Cubs. And usually, if, you know, if we're playing the Dodgers, I'll read the LA Times and all the Dodger news. Then I'll just look at what's going on around baseball, maybe some of the recaps from the night before. I'll take a shower. I'll, you know, maybe spend a few minutes with my family, and then I'll head off to the ballpark. And I usually try to get there between 9 and 10. The clubhouse opens around 9:50, 3.5 hours before game time. So I go down there, try to talk to the manager, catch batting practice, talk to the media relations staff, see if anything's going on. I'll probably pop over to the visitors clubhouse. Then by 11:15, I'm up in the booth with JD, and we're talking about what we may do on the pregame show. Our producer comes in, and we just kind of have an informal meeting. And then around 11:30, 11:45, we'll go grab some lunch. And then at that point, it's just final preparations, make sure the scorecard's ready to go. And we hit the air at 1. There's not a lot of downtime when I get to the ballpark, even though I get there usually about 4 hours before game time. And, you know, I always try to be as efficient as I possibly can and use every extra minute before we go on the air to prepare for that day's game.
So given that hectic schedule, when's the last time you just watched a game, you know, as a fan without hours of preparation, or have you?
Yeah, I mean, we have some, you know, some Fox Saturdays and ESPN Sunday nights. You know, it usually is about 5 to 10 games a year that we don't broadcast. And I usually stay at home just because if I have a day off, I think, you know, it's best to just kind of take it and relax. And I usually watch a game at home, and I'll keep score as well. But, yeah, I think I'm able to watch as a fan. There are times when, you know, you're working every day for about 3 straight weeks, and then you get a day off and you're kind of happy about the day off. But then again, there's a game against the Cardinals or somebody, and you kind of feel left out and you want to call it. But usually by the time the game ends, I take a breath and I go, you know what, it was good to have the day off. And the next day I always come back to the ballpark really refreshed and with an extra bounce in my step. So, you know, as many times as I guess we'd rather be at the ballpark, it's probably not a bad idea every 3 or 4 weeks to get an extra day off.
Well, there's a lot of diehard Cubs fans that listen to you almost every day for, you know, 6 or 7 months straight. And I figure that probably amounts to close to 500 hours. And so after that much time, with the number of years that you've been with the Cubs, can you kind of describe the connection that you have with Cubs fans, or maybe more specifically the Cubs fans have with you?
Well, I mean, I can speak to it from my perspective. It's a fan base that is unlike any other. I started in Milwaukee. Great baseball fans up there. The Brewers were in the American League when I was covering them. They switched in 98. So I was there a few years after the switch to the NL. Then I went down to Florida and worked with the Marlins. And, you know, they've got a good fan base as well. It's just not very big. So then you come to Chicago and you hear all the stories. And, you know, I've been coming to Wrigley for a long time as a visiting broadcaster. But it's overwhelming at times, and I think in a good way. And the best way for me to describe it is just – I have this kind of vibe and sense in the back of my mind when big things happen in a game and when awful things happen in a game, I just feel Cub fans either being elated or completely dejected. And obviously with Twitter these days, you get kind of an immediate reaction with all the various blogs dedicated simply to the Cubs. I check out that stuff a lot. I still take a lot of criticism from some people. They have very specific tastes in terms of what they want, in terms of the play-by-play and their announcers. But anytime I have discussions with people who want me to do something differently, I mean, the best way to answer it is just, I am who I am, and I think that people here want you to be yourself as much as possible. And that's the one thing about Chicago I really appreciate is it's a very loyal fan base, but they want you to be genuine and they want you to be yourself. And I've always been that way. And I think, you know, going into my 10th year now, I've been on the air enough. I've gotten to know everybody here. I think I've been able to let my hair down quite a bit over the last 5 or 6 years. And I would like to think, you know, most Cub fans have a pretty good idea of what I'm all about. And that's the fun of this. You're right. We're on the air for 500 hours a year. It can't all be nuts and bolts baseball. We try to have as much fun as we possibly can without detracting from the game. And as we know, the last 2 or 3 years have not been terribly successful on the field. So we've got to keep people watching for as long as possible. And many times that involves talking about other things.
So do you have a couple of favorite moments, you know, from that 10-year span?
Well, the one that stands out, I mean, obviously the 07 and 08 seasons with Lou at the helm, with, you know, huge payrolls, a lot of star players. I remember the Aramis Ramirez game against the Brewers in late June of 07. The Cubs were about 7.5 games out, and that really started their run toward the division title when he hit that first pitch slider off Francisco Cordero. And, you know, I lost my mind. I mean, it was just one of those plays where you become a fan instantly, even though you're supposed to be a pro. And I think that was one moment where maybe some Cub fans who weren't quite sure about me realized that I care very deeply about how this team does on a daily basis. And, you know, that one certainly stands out. The following year, from a broadcasting perspective, we did a 60th anniversary show against the Braves when both teams wore the throwback uniform, celebrating WGN's inaugural broadcast back in 1948. And, you know, I wanted to do a Jack Brickhouse call on a home run, but the Cubs didn't hit any home runs early. But Jim Edmonds in the bottom of the ninth had a game-tying home run to left, and I was able to break out a little Brickhouse. So that was a fun moment that certainly stands out. Yeah, I would say 07 and 08 in particular were, you know, chock full of really cool moments.
So can you tell us a little more about the home run call? You know, every broadcaster tries to, I think, develop their signature call. Has yours been the same, or has it kind of evolved over time as you've worked?
Yeah, I don't really know if I have one. And I think that you go through periods where you try some stuff out. And, you know, my for better or for worse, and that's probably, you know, one criticism I've heard from people is that, you know, some want me to have a home run call. I've never really studied it and really thought that hard about it because I don't want it to be contrived. And there are a lot of great home run calls around baseball that have developed over, you know, 20, 25, 30 years. But there are some others I hear where a home run doesn't really fit the call. And I, especially on television, I just don't want to, you know, that when people can see the trajectory of the ball, I want to make sure that I'm giving that home run its due in terms of that particular moment. And, you know, I really fight as hard as I possibly can the idea of being predictable. It's a game of routine. We're on every single day. There are certain things that, you know, Cub fans certainly get used to hearing from us, but my experience as a listener, maybe more than anything else, is when I can kind of predict what the broadcaster is going to say next, I start to tune out a little bit. And I don't ever want to be that guy who has the same call for every play. So, you know, I'm going to make mistakes as a result. I think the one thing about having a home run call is that you can always kind of, you can always go to it, even in a big moment. And, you know, it usually never fails you in that regard. But as I said, I don't want every game winning home run to sound the same. I want it to sound unique to that moment. And I feel like I'm giving that particular play its proper due if I simply react to it as naturally as I possibly can.
Yeah, I think that's a interesting way. I've never really thought about that, but I think it being a little bit more organic, it makes it sincere and it kind of captures the moment a little bit better.
Yeah, and again, it doesn't come without risk. You know, not that I'm necessarily going to screw it up. I'm not really worried about making mistakes per se, but you know, you maybe at times number one, I don't want to search for words when that moment happens. That's number one. And number two, I think that it can feel and maybe even sound a bit, not forced necessarily, but routine, I guess, if you go to the same place all the time. And, you know, obviously there's an intensity of a call in a ninth inning game tying or game winning homer versus maybe a first or second inning home run. But if you're saying the exact same thing, I just think that feels a little too easy to me. So, you know, a home run in the first inning on the road should not sound the same as one in the eighth inning and, you know, a big spot to tie a game. So everybody has a different philosophy. That's just the one I've always had.
Yeah. Well, and you have kind of an interesting role in your position. And I'm curious, do you consider yourself a journalist? Are you a member of the Cubs organization, or are you kind of something in between? And how do you balance those things as a broadcaster?
Yeah, that's a really good question. A journalist, not per se. I mean, I'm a broadcaster. I'm you know, I'm there to kind of give you what's happening in the game, to try to obviously set up my partner and let him shine and analyze. The number one goal for what I do is to get it right, to report all the information that's pertinent. I'm not the type of broadcaster who's ever going to not tell you something that happened to a Cub player, even if it's negative, if it pertains to what is going on in the game. So in other words, you know, and I haven't really faced this situation, but if somebody gets arrested and isn't in the lineup, you know, I'm going to tell you that. And I don't think the Cubs would ever tell me not to tell you that. I'm allowed to give my opinion and be frustrated. But I also think that one big part of my job, because we're on every single day, is I want to be that even keel. I want to be the steady one. And because Cub fans are all over the map and ride that roller coaster every single day, you know, I've told a couple people who say, you know, we want you to get more upset. We want you to kind of bring the fans' perspective to the call. And my response is, I don't need to tell you how to feel. You know, if you get upset at this team, you're mad, you're angry. I don't need to tell you to be angry. I think that's insulting of me to tell fans how to feel. I would never do that. I'm just going to give them what's going on. And the way I answer the idea of, you know, you don't talk about the negative stuff, when we go on the air and I say the Cubs are 25 games under 500 and in last place, that kind of says it all. I don't know what more I need to add. It's not a talk show. You're going to get enough of that stuff and overly opinionated conversation before and after the game. And I don't believe that generally that three-hour window is where most people want to hear it. If I mirrored the fans' thoughts on a daily basis, it would get really frustrating and annoying after a while, because people would say, man, he's really negative. And I don't really want that to be the case. I want to have fun and I want to keep people entertained.
You can leave the overly analytical stuff to us. all right. So let's talk about a little bit of the positive side of things. And you did experience a World Series win as a broadcaster when you were with the Marlins, and you were even lucky enough to get a ring from the Marlins. Is there ring wearing etiquette, or does that thing have to stay in the box?
Well, this one's the biggest one ever made, and it just does not wear well. It basically falls off my hand when I put it on. So I really don't wear it much. The only day I wore it was the day we received them. I wore it on the air. But also, now that I'm with a different team, and obviously that 03 season carries a little extra weight here, I don't wear it. And I can't tell you that I would wear the Cubs World Series ring every single day, because that's not really my style, but I would be thrilled to be able to wear it the day we get them. And, you know, I know that when that day happens, it's going to be spectacular. Obviously, the Cubs have never had a World Series ring, because the last time they won it, they didn't make such a thing. But I'm very fortunate to have one. I didn't really do anything to receive it. I just happened to be in the right spot at the right time.
So along those lines, I mean, you do work a whole season as a broadcaster for the team, and then you get to the sort of pinnacle in the World Series, and you're kind of left out of the booth. Is that a little tough to see it sort of get kicked over to the network side?
Yeah, I mean, we kind of know going in, that's the drill. You know, so the benefit is, you know, we get to be on every day pretty much throughout the year, and get a lot of exposure, and get to tell our fans what's happening on a daily basis. Once you get to the postseason, by and large, you're just an observer watching. But I'm always rooting for the team. You know, in 07 and 08, unfortunately, they were quick three and outs. It took about 4 days from start to finish, so it didn't last very long. But, you know, I was still doing some pre- and post-game stuff for WGN and Comcast, and, you know, might get an opportunity to help out on radio. But, you know, just those are the moments where you just kind of kick your feet up. And, you know, the other thing you got to remember is, even in a really good year, you know, I've done probably 180, 190 games, and sometimes it's nice just to take a deep breath and become a fan again.
Well, you kind of mentioned spring training and looking ahead when we started off here, and you'll have the opportunity to call some games in which these future prospects will be playing. With those young guys, what are you most interested in seeing from them?
Well, you know, without going through every single guy, and there are a lot of them, and I was really struck by the incredible quantity of not just prospects, but really high-end prospects who showed up at the Cubs convention. You know, over the course of my tenure here, usually they bring in a prospect or two, but it was like 15 to 20 guys. I mean, it really, really got me excited. But I'll just bring up a couple of guys in particular. Javier Baez, I know what he can do offensively, and while it's fun to watch him hit, I want to watch him play shortstop. And, you know, if he gets a chance to play a little second or a little third, I'm definitely curious how he fares at those positions. Jason McLeod has stated pretty emphatically that he believes Baez can play short at the big league level right now. And, you know, that's not a pressing issue at the moment, but I think over the course of the next 6 to 12 months, it could be, especially depending on the year Starlin Castro has. So I want to see him. You know, C.J. Edwards came over from Texas. I haven't seen him pitch in person. So I want to see some of these young hurlers in game action. You know, a lot of people have said, and for the most part, it's correct, that the Cubs don't have a ton of pitching depth, but they have more now than they did a couple of years ago as a result of a lot of trades they made. I want to see Chris Bryant. Very excited about seeing him. He may be as close to the big leagues as any of their prospects. So I just like watching these kids play. You know, if we don't see Bryant or Baez or Almora or Soler at the big league level this year, this is going to be my only opportunity to see those kids in person. And while the games don't necessarily count, they count big time for them. And I know the big league staff's pretty excited about watching them as well.
So, so any big league storylines then that you're looking forward to?
Well, the obvious one is Starlin, you know, coming off by far the worst year of not only his big league career, but of his baseball life. I really do expect him to have a good season. You know, can he hit 300 again? I would like to think he should be able to hit 300 a lot over the course of his career, but this is an important year for him. He's got a new manager now. He's got a new hitting coach. You obviously want to see defensive improvement, but this team really struggled to score runs, and I think more than anything else, they're really going to rely on their shortstop and their first baseman to you know, I won't say earn their contract per se, but these guys are going to be here for a while. They've got the big contracts, and I think that Theo and Jed and Rick Renteria, they're going to be relying pretty heavily on these guys. And, you know, they could be their 2 and 3 hitters. They're 1 and 3 hitters. We know Rizzo will hit third. And I think it just remains to be seen where Castro will line up. But I would be surprised if he's not in those top two spots.
Well, Len, we don't want to take up any more of your time. But before we let you go, we know that music is a big part of your life. Do you have any current music recommendations to share with our listeners?
I would say if I could mention one name, it would be Jake Bugg, who I believe turns 20 this month. He's from England. I happened to see him at Metro last year. The first time he came to Chicago, he played at the Ginger Man. The next time he played a sold-out show at Metro, and then he came back last month and played a sold-out show at the Riviera. So I guess next in line is probably Soldier Field. I had a chance to meet him after the Metro show. He's a great kid, and he's got the Johnny Cash, Simon and Garfunkel, Bob Dylan thing going, and I think has a chance to be a superstar in the rock world. He's got 2 albums out, and they're both really, really good, and I hope he's around for a long time to come. Check him out.
Cool. All right, Len. Well, we thank you very much for your time and for coming on the podcast, and we look forward to watching many hours of Cubs baseball this season and listening to you call the games.
Sounds good, guys. First game again the 27th at brand new Cubs Park in Mesa, and JD and I will be on WGN.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Okay, guys.
One Friday night, I took a pill or maybe 2. Down at the car park, I saw everyone I knew. And before the night was started, we had planned to crash a party. Just a place that someone knew. Local house belonging to a gangster's
We'd like to thank you for listening to the IVMV podcast and have tried to make it easy for you to find it. You can listen on our site, www.ivmv.com. You can listen and download in iTunes. Or if you have an iPhone or an Android phone, check out the apps that allow you to download or stream our episodes. We are on Stitcher, Pocket Casts, TuneIn, and many more. If you do have an iTunes account, you can help us out by going and giving us a rating and a review. We appreciate your feedback, and thanks for listening to the IVMV podcast. Happens every time I don't talk for a while. Whenever I play an interview here, I come back, I got a big bubble in my throat. I'm gonna do that over again. All right, I gotta do that over again. Hold on. That was ridiculous. All right, so that was Len Kasper, and I thought it was really cool to talk to Len. I like him a lot, and thought it was really cool to hear some of his thoughts. Did anything stand out to you guys as we listened to that?
Yeah, sometimes I get tired of trying to decide how I feel about this team, and I wish Len would just tell me how to feel.
make the decision for us.
But no, I thought it was funny when he was talking about how sometimes he feels the pull of the matchup during the Fox or the ESPN broadcast on the weekends. If, you know, it's like a Cubs Cards broadcast right. By Fox or whatever. And I wonder if he's ever listening to, and he's, you know, listening to the audio and just like, ah, screw this, and mutes it, and then just starts calling it himself.
That would have been a good follow-up question to that.
Yeah, I thought, I thought like what he said about his role and kind of being honest about the team, I thought that was interesting, and I think it would be, you know, difficult to be a broadcaster in the position that this team has been in for the last few years. And, you know, he mentioned, you know, fans, there are some fans, first off, it just, his job would be hard because no matter what you do, people are probably, you know, going to be very vocal about their disapproval of everything that you do. And to hear, like, I was kind of surprised. I never really thought about fans wanting to hear somebody vocalizing like they're like discouraged and disgruntled feelings. That, I don't know that, but you know, but I liked what he said, that if I say the Cubs are 25 games under 500, that's kind of all I need to say, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, right, so and something that he, I guess, like his role isn't the same as the color commentator's role, is kind of more the guy who's supposed to represent the fans' voice, I guess, you know, right, and so right. He's been blessed, you know, to have Bob Brenly, who did a good job at, you know, being critical when it was appropriate, and I think, you know, JD, I haven't heard a whole lot, but I mean, it seems like he also is going to be a blessing to have in the booth alongside Len, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I was going to say, should we just tell them to reveal our secret that was really just Andy doing his Len Kasper impersonation. That's what we do.
You really nailed it, Andy.
Yeah. He's been working on it for the entire offseason, and he finally got it, so we thought now is the time to do this Len Kasper interview.
Right.
That's funny that you picked me as the guy who would be doing that. Like, I'm no. Terrible at impressions and accents and stuff like that.
All right. Well, thanks again to Len for coming on the podcast and talking with us. And it was kind of nice to hear his voice. You know, it's been a while, and just hearing him talk, I was kind of like, okay, it's time for baseball. Let's go. Let's do this.
Yeah, it was interesting to hear his voice through the headphones, and it's such a different context ever after listening to him on TV for so long. It's kind of a weird experience, but really cool.
Yeah. Well, let's move on to some Cubs talk. The Cubs did avoid arbitration with all of the players that were eligible this year. And so here's a list of players that the Cubs signed and the amount that they agreed on. Pedro Strop, $1.325 million. James Russell, $1.775 million. Val Buena, $1.71 million. Shearholz, $5 million. Travis Wood, $3.9 million. Justin Ruggiano, $2 million. Darwin Barney, $2.3 million. And then the last one, Jeff Samardzija, $5.345 million.
Got in that last 50 grand. That's
yeah, I saw a comment on some site that somebody said that last $45,000 was a mullet premium or something like that. I forget where I saw that. But, yeah, so the Samardzija settled figure was slightly above the midpoint between what the Cubs were offering, which was 4.4, and Samardzija's filing for $6.2 million. Epstein has a good track record of avoiding arbitration hearings, and this year was no different, although kind of came down to the wire with Samardzija. But that's a good thing, is that he's really doing a great job at avoiding the acrimony that going to a hearing can produce, a team having to make a case as to why a player is not worth the amount that they're asking for. So if you're looking for hope in the Cubs Samardzija thing and you want them to get Samardzija for a long-term deal, I mean, you can take that for a good sign, perhaps, is that neither side has really been, you know, disparaging toward the other in the media. And maybe that was like the Cubs saying, hey, you know, give you a little bit more than the midpoint. As sort of a step in the right direction if you're hoping for that long-term deal. I guess some people think that interpret the tardiness of this one-year deal as a bad sign, like that the two sides are pretty far apart you know, a long-term deal is going to be even more of a struggle to get done. But still, I think you can view it that the Cubs like that they're able to get Samardzija at a decent price. You know, just over $5 million is a great price for a pitcher of Jeff's caliber. And then the Cubs can wait and see deeper in the season, of, you know, if he's still pitching well and whether he will still fit their needs for the long term and stuff like that. And then on Samardzija's end of it, I mean, he's a player who is confident in his skills. He thinks he's going to pitch at a high enough level to net a great long-term deal, whether it's with the Cubs or another team. So he probably sees his position as a favorable one also.
Yeah, I think, I don't know, I hope that's the case. I hope that optimism is actually what's going on and that the talks for a long-term deal will come back around. I suspect that he'll be gone before the trade deadline, but, you know, obviously it's entirely speculation. So I don't, to me, it sort of signaled that not doing a long-term deal now meant that they just couldn't get it done. And from the Cubs' perspective, to do it after this year, let's say he does complete the season with the Cubs and has a good season, that only ups that value. So I don't know.
Right. They still have another year of club control.
Right.
Yeah, he's through 2015. He's eligible, free agent eligible in 2016.
Right. So then, you know, given my ignorance over the arbitration process, so once this contract's up, they just do it all over again at the end of this year to try to lock him into a long-term or short-term deal.
Or just another one-year deal, yeah. And if you're interested in the whole arbitration process and everything, I mentioned this 2 weeks ago when we were talking about arbitration, but Fangraphs did a really interesting podcast episode on arbitration, and I will try to remember to include the link to that episode in the show notes for this episode, but it was really interesting, and yeah, you don't want it to get to that hearing.
Yeah, and plus it's a gamble for the player to let it get to the hearing, as you know, I guess it's a panel has to decide on either what the club offered or what the player filed for. So
one or the other.
Like Jeff could have ended up getting the $4.4 million that the Cubs offered. So it really was kind of the safe bet for him to settle for the 5.345.
And it's just a bad, you kind of hit, you know, mentioned this, Andy. I mean, it's just bad for, we perceive it as being bad for the clubhouse. You know, basically in that arbitration hearing, the club would need to say, this is why Samardzija is not worth what he's asking for. And so you're kind of running him down a little bit, and I think if it would have gone to arbitration, you could pretty much kiss a long-term deal goodbye. And I don't think,
yeah,
I think he's got too much pride. We'll call it pride. Some may call it ego, but we'll call it pride.
I gotta think it would be a little bit harder for the Cubs to prove why Samardzija wasn't worth what he wanted than it was for them to prove why Terrio wasn't worth what he wanted.
Yeah, yeah, that was really the last, and I wish I could remember. Wasn't the one before him like Leon Durham or something? Like, I mean, it had been a long time.
These are kind of rare, yeah.
I kind of made that up. I don't know if it was Leon Durham, but it was a long time.
wasn't it Frank Chance?
Yeah.
It's like before
it had been
free
a really
agents.
Long time. And, you know, Hendry, I had not gone to arbitration until Terrio. And the Cubs did win. The Terrio arbitration hearing, so obviously they agreed that he wasn't worth anything. Then he went off and won 2 World Series rings. Not that he had a large role in that, but still salt in the wound.
But yeah, it'll be nice that now these guys can actually get to camp on time, right. and it's all behind them. You know, we can forget about it at least for the near future,
right. Yeah, now those guys can just get focused on 2014.
Winning some ball games.
That's right. Oh, man. Okay, well, anything else you guys want to talk about this arbitration stuff?
I don't think so.
No, there'll be plenty of rumors to come.
Yeah, yeah. I'm looking forward to kind of the increased, you know, once those beat reporters get out to Arizona. You know, there'll be a lot of stories, and I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to hearing some just what's going on out there and stuff, and which players are getting injured in, you know, squad scrimmages.
And some players are already down there putting in work. So, you know, Edwin Jackson's already been throwing, for example. So it's exciting that we're getting close to baseball. I'm excited.
Yeah, me too. All right, well, let's do our internet muscle flex. I have a couple, but if this is the first time you've listened to our podcast, what we do is we go to Cubs.com, look through the comments section of the articles, and then we find instances of commenters flexing their internet muscles on other commenters, on the Cubs, the players, the other the author of the article, really just anybody is fair game for these guys. And so we just kind of poke a little fun at them. And I have a couple, but they're not amazing, I guess. They're not as high caliber as I was hoping for, but how many do you guys have?
I have one.
Okay, well, let me do two of them, and then we can do our round. Okay, so this one is on the article that was about the Cubs doing a day-night doubleheader with the Nationals, I think, because some parade or some festival or something or other is going on in Wrigleyville. You can tell I paid a lot of attention to that article. I had heard about it. I just knew there was a doubleheader. I'd seen it on Twitter and stuff, and I was like, yeah, that's all I need to know. And so this is, I'm kind of assuming this might be a Nationals fan, because I think that this was posted. This is one of those articles that's posted to both sites, and right. The person's screen name or whatever you want to call it has DC in it. So I'm going to assume they're Nationals fan, but I don't know. Anyways, she comments, "I already had tickets for the Saturday game. Is that the early game or the late game now? Flying in from DC, so I need to know." And the commenter says,
"Oh boy, here we go.
It's February. The game isn't until June. You have to know today which game your tickets are for. LOL." Another foaming at the mouth, mentally challenged Cubs fan. Next.
Oh no, it's that guy.
yeah, that's hilarious, because I think I should go next, and you'll know why. So,
emphasis on the word next.
The funny thing is that, well, you'll see. But the first part of this, I am going to read it as written. I just don't want it to come across like maybe this person, English is not their first language. I don't know. I'm just gonna read it as written. And well, I don't wanna sound insensitive. But anyways, it's not even the funniest part. All right, so here we go. "As each season that begins, always I hope the miracle. So I feel that this season could be special. Wrigley Fields has a century, and I see an manager with desire to do the things and do the miracle. Renteria isn't a mechanic man. He's a man that like be friend of the players, know them. And he doesn't think on the rebuilding season. He thinks on an winner season." So that's that one. That's that part of it.
I saw this one.
And then our friend says, "Put down the pom-poms, Junior, and wipe the foam off your mouth, for God's sake." So, and he left off his catchphrase. And then the next person says, "You should wipe the dingleberries from your mouth."
I saw that.
How did you not choose that one?
I don't know.
I mean, it had amazing writing to start with, and then people making fun of him, and the foam. Oh. Apparently, he likes foam as much as he likes next.
And then anytime anybody. That's my news. Anytime anybody mentions dingleberries, I'm reading it.
You know, dingleberries.
It's my new Kurt Fart joke. If you can work dingleberries into the next photo caption contest, I'm voting for you.
That's happening. All right, that's mine.
Did you have another one, Corey, or is it?
I have one more. I thought I had three, but really I just had two. So you can go ahead and mine's not very good. Is yours pretty good?
I like it. Yeah.
All right. Mine's pretty crummy, so I'll whatever.
All right. Well, here we go. Here's mine. So one play, I like this. I think this comment is interesting. They're talking about projected payroll for the Cubs, and it's projected to be, this one commenter talks about their payroll is projected to be just over 85 million. I'm sorry. And they're paying for players who won't be on the roster, you know, like they owe Soriano $14 million still.
Right.
Jorge Soler, $2.6 million. Gerardo Concepcion, they're paying him too. And so if you take $17 million some change away from 85, you end up with just over $68 million for your, you know, what they're paying that you're actually going to see on the field. And that is low. Like, I was thinking about that. Like, in 2010, their payroll was over $144 million. But anyway, so then another commenter says, hang on, I got to scroll down a little bit. Are they trying to get it to zero? LOL. And then another person comments on that. Come on, the front office thugs are trying to get us to where we're so dang good the superstars will pay us to play. LOL.
LOL.
I just found those two comments to be kind of incomprehensible, so I enjoyed it. But I thought the initial one about, you know, just thinking about what they're paying was interesting.
I did see that string of conversation.
Yeah, I did too. Well, my last one here is on Ryan Kalish. Ryan's his first name, right? Yeah, okay.
Right.
It's like, wait a minute, is that right? Anyway, so this is the article about it's Kalish more appreciative with, or yeah, I must have typed that wrong. Anyways, with injury woes past, it's about his injuries that he's had, and he had the same surgery as Peyton Manning. And so someone commented, if he can have half the success Peyton has, I think it's a very good thing for the Cubs. The next person says, I'm not sure 2,750 passing yards and 27.5 TDs will factor much into the Cubs' results.
Couldn't hurt.
Couldn't hurt.
How many runs does a touchdown equate to?
Oh man. So, yeah, I kind of thought there were, I spent quite a bit of time trying to find those. So I thought there'd be more of it, man. You know, Kerry Muscat's going to be pumping out some articles during spring training. So there's going to be some good stuff.
Yeah. Well, and then once the baseball starts, we can sprinkle the scary stats back in there too. So
yeah, I'm looking forward to those scary stats.
Yeah, we're hoping we have a hard time finding scary stats, but
I have a feeling
they're gonna be everywhere.
In all honesty, yeah, we're gonna have a lot of them.
I think they're gonna be as easy to find as our you know, Kurt, your 2-year-old son's Easter eggs hidden,
bright pink and in the middle of the lawn,
right. Speaking of our kids, did you guys go see the Lego movie this weekend?
I haven't. I just watched the previews like 4 times.
We did, and it was great. I loved it.
Yeah, I thought I almost fell asleep in it, but other than that, I thought it was awesome.
Yeah, well, okay.
And we went to the 11 a.m. showing. We went to the 11 a.m. showing, and I almost fell asleep.
Wow.
But so did my daughter. My you know, she'll be turning 7 here next week, and she almost fell asleep in it too. But it was kind of like, I thought the first half was a little bit slow, but yeah, then it picked up in the second half and got pretty awesome.
It picks up a lot, but yeah, I was thoroughly entertained the whole time. I loved it.
It was good.
And I looked over at my son. I looked over at my son, you know, a few times, and he was just sitting there, mouth agape, like his mouth was actually open, like a little mouth breather, like for a bunch of the movie.
He's a Lego kid, though.
Yeah, he loves them.
I like his little Chad Pergracki ship he has.
Yeah. Garbage barge.
That's for our Quad Cities listeners. All right, so let's do the photo for this week's caption contest, and I think this picture was taken at Cubs Convention, and it is Samardzija is in the foreground, I guess, and Epstein is behind him, standing behind him, and so they're both smiling and kind of walking away from each other, it looks like. So we do post these pictures on our Facebook page. Again, you can get there going to ivmv.com/Facebook, and I post them to Google Plus, ivmv.com/Google, and then I also post them on Instagram. We're at IVMV Podcast. So I'll read the Google Plus and Instagram ones. And
what if you do like the first, I don't know, third of the Facebook ones too?
Okay, except I don't have that. I don't have Facebook open. Okay. Kurt, do you want to do with the first third of those?
Sure.
Okay. All right, so here is Matthew on Google Plus. He says, Theo, no shark. I'll leave the locks with you. All I need is the suit. He's kind of, it looks like he's taking his suit jacket off, I guess. Okay, so then on Instagram, this is from, I have to read these that are not real names. These are kind of hard. Mr. Wassum. And Mr. Wassum says, offer still on the table, big fella. All that stands between you and 6 million is a date with Starlin's hairdresser. Jerry curl it, bro. The next one is from Joe. He actually told me on here that we can call him Joe, so that was kind of nice of him. He says, man, we should really sign that guy if I could just spell his name. Jarlo Samarmel? Next. and then Hey Krebs, they say your hair smells real good, Jeff Samardzija. So yeah, Samardzija's nose is kind of resting in this picture, resting on Epstein's head.
The perspective in this picture is awesome.
All right, Kurt, you want to read some of those Facebook ones?
Sure. Oh boy, we started off with a doozy. I'm gonna censor slightly just because we might have some young listeners. All right, but Nick says, "Yeah, f you too." But he just wrote the whole thing. So just in case we got some kids on the podcast. Another one from Nick says, "You know what I'm looking forward to? Not having to figure out how to spell your goddamn name every time we have." To cut your check. That would be awesome if Theo hand wrote all of the checks to all of them. All right, next one is from Sean. Hey, Jeff, you got a little Theo on your nose. Which Jeff's nose is like touching the top of Theo's head. It's kind of cool. Another one from Sean. A stunning twist to the Samardzija trade or extension drama, the Chicago Cubs announced today that Theo Epstein and Jeff Samardzija are in fact conjoined twins.
It's kind of funny if you think that they are like at the same level, and like Epstein is like half the size.
He's tiny.
Weird forced perspective trick. It's like when they filmed The Hobbit and made Ian McKellen look huge compared to Joan or whoever the actor is that played Frodo.
So the next one is from Doug. Next couple are. He says, "Why yes, I am playing pocket pool." another one from Doug. Do you use Head and Shoulders? Do you know Troy Polamalu? Jason says, "You smell purdy." does look like he's sniffing his head. I lost my spot. Okay. From Benjamin, Jeff, I smell bullshit. That can't possibly be coming from you, can it, Theo? All right, Andy, I'll let you take it from there.
All right, Michael says, Theo, almost there. A tie, a shave, and a haircut, and you won't look like a dirty hippie in a monkey suit anymore. Oh, no. Mike says, dude.
It does kind of look like what their conversation is right there.
Yeah. Michael also says, think of me like Yoda, but instead of being little and green, I wear suits and I'm awesome and I'm your bro. I'm Broda.
Okay, now that's got to be a movie quote, right? That I'm
it is in quotes.
With. Yeah.
Justin writes, thought bubble over both. Yeah, keep smiling, you son of a bitch. Oh my. Ken says, Theo, hey Jeff, did you just crop dust me? Jeff. No, it was the new mascot, Clark. I don't know. I think that kind of stays inside the suit. I think
right. You're just punishing yourself. Yeah.
I think it's in Clark's. It behooves Clark to hold that in until the suit's off. Tim says, "Hey Theo, as I walk out, picture my ass in Yankee pinstripes." Oh.
Oof.
Oof.
I don't know if I can handle that one.
Yikes. Katie says, "Jeff, Tressman called. He's looking for a wide receiver." then we have a caption from Jeff, and it reads, "You think I'm going to pay you that much?" Jeff, "You better, because I'm the best pitcher you got."
Ooh.
Just kind of real life. Jeff, another Jeff, different Jeff than the aforementioned Jeff, says, "Oh, hey, Jeff, say, Jeff, do you have that $20K I loaned you in Vegas? That's cool if you don't have it on you. Jeff, Jeff, good talking to you. Don't forget your sunscreen for Mesa. You can just use mine again. You know, if you forget... Jeff." That probably is kind of what their relationship is like. Same Jeff chimes in with, "You know what? Don't worry about, I've got a whole bunch of extras, so I'll pack enough for us both. Oh, it's no big deal." That must be a continuation of the caption before, which I just now realized. But anyway, I liked it.
Butchered.
Butchered. Just officially... butchered. My bad, Jeff. Eric writes, "Theo, your sister was fantastic last night."
Why'd you have to read it like that?
I don't know. I thought it was good. I think it added to it. All right, and then a longtime caption entrant, Terry, has a few for us here. The first one, "What's this I hear about you whipping your hair back and forth? That's not number one starter material." The next one, Theo, "Rock, paper, rock, scissors for arbitration." Jeff, "Sure." Theo, "Rock." Jeff, "Paper. Looks like I'm going to get paid, son. Show me the money." Terry also says, "Theo, there can only be one Highlander." Jeff kind of does look like a Highlander. Terry also has another one here. "Theo, yeah, I traded off some of your favorite teammates. You mad, bro?" You missing Feldman? That's a pretty great one. Another one from Terry. "Theo, I said pass the horsey sauce. Why you always got to be playing around ever since Corey from IBM paid all that money for your game worn jockstrap? You think you king dick around here, huh?"
Oh, man. Well, I think I'm going to go with... Oh, go ahead.
Go ahead. Go ahead, man.
I was just going to say, I think Terry's second to last one. I traded off your favorite teammates, you mad bro. I like that because, I mean, you know, Samardzija has been irritated in the past when that's happened.
Yeah. What was the second one on Instagram? I thought there was, like, a good one on Instagram.
Let me pull
it. Sorry to do that to you if you already closed it.
That's all right. The second one, offer still on the table, big fella. Or no, the second one, sorry. Man, we should just... Oh, I'm sorry. It's hard to read on this little thing. Man, we should really sign that guy. If I could just remember his name, Jarlo Samarmel. Next.
That's pretty funny.
I like that one.
Yeah, I can get on board with either one of those.
Yeah, I like that one. I also like Michael's I'm Broda one.
I'm going to go with that one, whoever that was from Instagram. I'm going to vote for that one. So, Andy, you have to choose between the two.
All right, Instagram.
All right, who was that?
Joe.
Cool.
So, congratulations, Joe. Very cool. All right. Well, looks like I have an edit right here.
Alrighty then.
Hold on. All right, here we go. All right, well, that does it for this week's episode. Thank you for listening and downloading. We hope that you enjoyed the Len Kasper interview. I thought it was really cool to be able to talk to him. I was kind of like excited about it all day that we did that.
Yeah.
He's like, I get to talk to Len today.
And now you have his email address. Watch out, Len.
Right. I'll just send him like weird political forwards and stuff like
that. BuzzFeed lists.
Yeah. Top 10 home run calls.
All right. Well, thank you for listening and downloading, and we will be back next week, next Sunday night at 8:30 p.m. Central. You can go to idmv.com/live to watch us do this in video. And until then, go Cubs. It was kind of nice during that interview. I was able to write all of our show notes.
Nice.
That works out well.
Yeah. So I think there was just like an edit at the beginning and then in and out of the interview, like there were some pauses because I had to like try to cue it up. And then there at
the end of the interview, right? When you came back from the after.
Oh,
the
yeah.
Interview.
I had a bubble in my throat.
The bubble.
That's right. I forgot about that. All right. Well, I think I'm going to go watch The Walking Dead.
Yeah, me too.
Quickly, I'm trying to make it brief, but my college roommate has a nephew who's like older and just out of college, and he has Chris connected me with him, and I don't know much about him, but he's worked for some minor league baseball teams like around, and he just moved to Des Moines. He's from Chicago.
And oh, yeah.
Is a huge Cubs fan, so he'll probably go to a lot of games if we ever want, like, a Des Moines, Iowa Cubs update or anything. So I'm going to send him a message. Like, I guess he's part of another blog or something and does a lot of minor league analysis. So
oh, really?
Might okay. be a good connection to have. I will. I just got a message from him tonight, so I will reply and maybe loop you in.
Yeah, that would be cool.
Okay, so, but yeah, he lives in Des Moines now, so that might be handy.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's cool. But,
alrighty. Well, hey, all right,
guys.
499 likes on Facebook. Almost there.
We got almost there.
Almost.
I bet we'll get there tomorrow.
Oh, there it is. It's there. 500.
Are you serious?
Yep. I just refreshed, and it was at 500.
Oh, hell yeah.
Get off my back. Facebook.
Suck it, Facebook.
Seriously, they have like this thing. It's like, oh, you're just a few, get to your next goal. You're almost there.
What exactly are you paying for then? Like fake likes? Like what?
Oh, if you pay. Well, basically, like you pay, you can pay for them to target. You can target people that have like Cubs in their profile and stuff like that. But it's like, I'm not going to pay for people, that's kind of a, I might pay, like I'll probably pay to promote this episode. So like I'll post it on Facebook, the link and everything. And then I'll throw like $5 or $10 at it just for that to get in front of more people. But I'm not going to pay for people to like our page.
Yeah. Bogus.
Well, all right, guys.
All right. Peace.
All right. See you guys later.
See you.